what would my life have been like if I had lived 150 years ago? That's always been kind of my entry point for history, the everyday experience, because I think that's going to connect with a lot more people, those stories.
What are the stories of the Dallas women who fought for our right to vote? How did their opinions change? And who should we be thanking today every time we go to the polls? So if you know anything about women's history and women's suffrage movement, you probably know two dates, 1848, the date of the Seneca Falls Convention in New York, and 1920, which is the date the 19th Amendment passed.
I always grew up reading about these strong women, grew up in a household where I was also surrounded by strong women. So my grandmother lived with us, and she was feisty. And then my mother, of course, also feisty. When I got to college, I took a class on women's history in college and was totally fascinated. And then I was actually an intern at the Women's Museum the summer before it opened. And so that was what really probably crystallized all of that. And, you know, just all of these amazing things and getting to know that history better really continued that.
March 1918 was an absolutely pivotal month for the women in Dallas as well as the state. By the end of the month, women had the right to vote in Texas primaries. Can you imagine the swirl of emotions they must have felt? I think exhaustion probably would have been there, elation and satisfaction. Within a week, the bill passed the Senate with a few amendments, went back to the House, and was signed into law on March 26, 1918. In a letter to Carrie Chapman Catt, Minnie Fisher Cunningham wrote, "When the final vote was taken, we rose to leave the gallery of the House, and when the men saw us, they all stood up and gave us a perfect ovation, cheering for some minutes and calling for a speech. It was a surprising and greatly appreciated tribute to the work that the women have been doing."
Sometimes in history, we think that history is always this forward march of progress and things that have happened. We're like, oh, of course, we were always destined to do these things. And that's not the case. I mean, this was a very long movement. I mean, the first conversation started in the 1840s, and the Federal Amendment didn't pass until 1920. But they just kept persisting. And, you know, they went from, let's look at equal rights for all women, to just focusing right now on the vote. In Dallas, Dallas had several false starts. So there was a group that got together in 1893, and then it faded pretty quickly by 1896 because there was a fight about whether or not Susan B. Anthony should be invited to visit Texas. Some people thought she was too radical. And then it got going up again in 1913. And Texas was slow to get involved. They were one of the last southern states to form a state suffrage association, but they were early in getting primary suffrage, so that was 1918, and then they were the first southern state to pass the Federal Amendment. Remembering that not everyone always had the right to vote, and people fought and died and struggled and worked really hard. And it's shameful that the city, for our local elections, has a turnout rate of less than 10%. I am one of those people that never misses an election because, and I think it's because partly because I know the history, that at one time I would not have been able to vote. And I think that's part of the importance of history is figuring out how, not just how did we as a group got here, but how did your unique life, what are you building on? What past struggles have made your life possible?
Remember these ladies and men who fought for your right to vote. So now let us applaud people like Minnie Fisher Cunningham, Isadora Calloway, aka Pauline Periwinkle, Barry Miller, Noni Mahoney, Mary Craig, and also let us applaud ourselves for caring about these stories in the first place.